Hi, it's Paul Andersen, and this is Life Science Disciplinary Core Idea 2A. It's on interdependent relationships in ecosystems. So this is at the level of ecosystems, so how communities, how biotic and abiotic factors all work together to create life on our planet. And so how do we get students to that level of understanding? Well, we start at the lower elementary grades by talking about animals and plants. And so what do animals like this meerkat require to survive? Well, they feed on insects. They feed on pretty much anything that they can find. So they need food, they need water, they need shelter, a place to live, and they're going to live underground. And then they need a suitable temperature, so it's not too hot and it's not too cold. But they really rely on plants. Even though they're eating a lot of animals, those animals are eating plants. And so animals are beholden to plants for food. Also for shelter a lot of the time. And so what do plants need then? Plants require air, water, minerals that they're taking in through their roots, and they also require material from the air, like carbon dioxide. But the big thing that I'm missing is they require light. How are they different than animals? Make sure your students understand that they can create their own food through photosynthesis. And animals have to either eat plants or things that eat plants. Now, plants don't have it all their own way. They can't move, and so they rely on animals to pollinate or to move their pollen around. And each of these plants are evolved to their specific environment, just like animals. And so a cactus is going to have different water requirements, obviously, than a lily pad. But they all do well where they live. As we move up in elementary, we should start to talk about levels of feeding and then food webs. And so the idea of what a producer is pretty important. A producer is going to be an organism that can produce their own food. And so plants are that. But there are other things like in the oceans, phytoplankton are really important producers on our planet. So they're producing food, and then that food is consumed. So consumers eat producers or eat things that eat producers. So as we move up, this would be a primary, secondary, and tertiary consumer. That means that they're eating things that eat plants or eating plants themselves. Now, those aren't the only two groups, producers and consumers, because when we die, we have to move the material back into the ecosystem again, and we do that using decomposers. And so worms or mushrooms and funguses are very important decomposers, and so are bacteria. And so we should really introduce the idea of a food web at this point. A food web is going to show how matter and energy moves in an ecosystem. And so, for example, this beetle is feeding on a tree, but it's eaten by a frog, which is eaten by a snake, which is eaten by a coyote. And so it's important that they understand where the arrow is moving and what it represents. It represents the movement of energy and matter. And so I shouldn't even have to have the diagrams on it, and you should be able to figure out what these two question marks are really representing. Since this one right here has arrows moving out from it, we know that it is a producer. And since this one only has arrows coming into it, we know that it is a consumer, a tree, and a coyote. Okay, now in an ecosystem, we want it to be healthy. And to be healthy, you have to have as many of these different relationships that you can. So big changes in one area aren't going to affect the whole of the ecosystem. So this is a food web, a simple food web of Lake Michigan. You can see how complex it is with all the producers and then the consumers and the consumers that eat them all the way up. Again, it's healthy if we've got a lot of species in a food web, but we can have things introduced into an area that can really decimate it. So the zebra mussel is an invasive species that was introduced into Lake Michigan. It's eating a lot of this phytoplankton, and so it's going to disrupt that whole food web all the way up. As we move into middle school, we really want to talk about the specifics of ecology. And for me, it's important that you understand what is an ecosystem, what is a community. And so I wrote this little BECPO. It's the way that I remember the different levels within ecology. It stands for biosphere, ecosystem, community, population, and organism. So an organism is one individual. A population would be all of those individuals in an area, like all the beetles in an area. A community is going to be all the populations that are interacting together. And then an ecosystem is going to be all the communities, but we also have to add one more thing to define an ecosystem, because all levels here within ecology have what are called biotic factors. Biotic factors means living factors, But when we get to the level of an ecosystem, then we add abiotic factors, things like light, water, availability to minerals, temperature, all those things are abiotic. And so we don't introduce those to the level of an ecosystem. So community is just going to be biotic factors. But once we get to an ecosystem, now we're adding things like abiotic factors. In a biosphere, what is that? That's simply all the ecosystems that we have on our planet. So it's important that you know the different levels of organization within ecology, and then some of these terms and how those populations interact. So competition is going to be individuals who share resources. And so, for example, these red deer are fighting, or they're competing. In this case, they're competing to mate with the females. But these anemones are fighting. They're actually fighting for control of this bottom part of the ocean. They're sharing those resources. Predation is different than that. Predation is when you have a predator and a prey, and the prey is eaten by the predator. So for example, this tiger feeding or these ants feeding on this katydid is going to be an example of predation. Mutualism is where they both benefit. And so an example that you're probably familiar with is the clownfish and the sea anemone, where the clownfish is immune to the toxins of the anemone and keeps things away from it and can clean up food and also brings food towards the anemone. Or pollination. So this hummingbird is getting nectar from the flower, so it's benefiting, but in return it's pollinating that flower. So these are all interactions now at the level of a community. And so populations tend to increase over time. And so when we now get to the level of high school, we should be talking about population growth, exponential growth. And so basically any population, it doesn't matter what it is, elephants for example, if they all reproduce and they all survive, they're going to show what's called exponential growth. Even though it takes a long time for them to reproduce, I mean, just think of humans, it takes quite a while, decades for us to reproduce, but we're seeing exponential growth right now. And so if you have the requirements for life, if you have the abiotic and biotic factors required for life, then populations will always undergo exponential growth. What that means is that they're going to increase very, very dramatically and very quickly. But over time, you're eventually going to deplete those biotic and abiotic factors. You're going to run out of resources, and so you're eventually going to hit something called a carrying capacity. Carrying capacity is the maximum amount of organisms that an area can support. And so it doesn't look like this. It's not all smooth. This is just a mathematical representation. Let me give you an example of what this looks like. And so the wolves were reintroduced into Yellowstone Park in the early 90s, and this is the data. Since the early 90s until today. And basically this blue bar is going to show all the wolves in Yellowstone Park, and then you have the numbers over here on the side. And so what happened to the numbers in Yellowstone Park? Well, they went through exponential growth. They got really a number of wolves in the park grew dramatically. And then what happened is they started to deplete their resources. They ate too many elk, ate too many bison, ate too many deer, and eventually the population drops down. And it comes up and it comes down. And so we get this nice oscillation where the predators start to drop off. Now the prey can come back. But really what we have is now a carrying capacity. In other words, this is going to be the maximum number of wolves that Yellowstone Park can support. And so now we're at the level of an ecosystem. So we're at the level of organisms interacting with both the biotic and abiotic factors. And I hope that's helpful.